So I can start both the containers. So I'm going to start one container, which is actually going to host Fabric 1.4 and then related dependency. So I have started that container, okay? So let me start another container. Okay, so here I'm going to start another container with the Fabric master. So I'm running two containers now. So you can see that if I do go version, so here you will see a different go version and here you will see a different go version. Okay, so I'm not there is no virtual machine here, just there is a Docker container, and without using go I am actually showing two different view to the process. Okay, so that's what Docker does. Okay, let me close. Okay, yeah, this is obviously a good solution for me, right? So I can use Docker. So that's what I use it for, the everyday day-to-day development. Okay, let's look at other uses. This is, I mean, whatever I showed is not the only use of container. There are a lot of other uses as well. So one is to easily distribute development environment. Suppose say tomorrow I am getting a new laptop, and whenever I get a new laptop, I need to install a lot of tools, right? Because I have some development environment, and you can see that this is like something like fish shell, similar to bash shell. And also I use NVIM. So it's like a Vim for, you can say it's like a lightweight IDE. So these are the things I need to set up again in the new laptop. That's take a lot of time. So if I install everything in a container, I can just move the container whenever I get a new laptop. So I don't need to worry about reinstalling all my development environment. The second is, in order to deploy application on multiple servers quickly. Suppose say I have built some application and the application become very popular, and everywhere across the world people are using it, and I want to host the application in, suppose say, Azure and then IBM as well as in Google. So I can just create a Docker container image and then give it to all the cloud provider, and we can start it very easy. And also to deploy microservices and to restrict resources used by the application. And finally, to increase the server utilization as well. So if I run VM, that time also I can increase the server utilization. But the problem is that the VM actually wastes a lot of memory because of the duplication of guest OS and then the respective data structure. So with Docker, I could actually host more application and efficiently use the resources. Okay. So now, I mean, we understood the differences between, I mean, we understood what is virtual machine and then what is container. So now we need to see that how the container is being built. So it's very interesting, right? They have removed the guest operating system, but still they show two different view to a different process. So for that, we need to first understand what is the difference between two VMs. So if I have two VMs, what are the things that could be different? Suppose, let's see. So I'm having both the VMs here. So this is one VM and this is another VM. So, so if I look at host name, so it says Fabric V2, and here if I say host name, it says Fabric V1. Okay, so you can see that the host names are different, and what else could be different? Probably file system and mounts, that also could be different. So here just look at last three. So I have some mounts here, and then if I go back to this VM, so you can see that I have mounted some media as well. Okay, so the mount point is also different. So similarly, we can have a different users, a different process, and then different network, and then different resource allocation for VM as well. So these are the differences I can get from two VMs. Okay, so now the question is it possible to create these differences without using two operating system? Okay, that's the question. Okay, so yes, it is possible. Okay, so that's how we create the container. So how it is possible? That is the second question, right? So the Linux provide two things. One is like a Linux namespaces. So namespaces, what it controls is, so it can control a view. I mean, for example, what a process view as a host name or a file seen by a process. So all the things the namespace can control. Okay. So if we can control that, we can show different view to a different process. And without using multiple operating system, we can actually get those differences. And there is another thing which is called control group. It basically actually restrict the resources used by the application. So let's look at what is the namespace and then control groups. Even in your lab session, you will be creating namespaces whenever you create a namespace, it's nothing but you are creating a container. So basically in this session as well as in the lab, you will be creating container from scratch without using any of the tool that is available to create containers. Okay, so the Linux has following namespaces. So each of the namespaces control a process view. For example, there is a mount namespace that actually controls files and mount points seen by the process. And similarly, we have one for hostname and then process and then network, inter-process communication, users and then C group. So these are the Linux version in which it was first added. And you can see that the first namespace was added in 2002. So there is something called Xen and KVM. So I'm sure some of you might be aware of it. Those are like a virtual machine. So that itself came in around 2004. Okay. So even in the Linux, people started to think about the providing the different namespaces even in 2002. And the development went over for like 14, 15 years, right? And even just in 2016 only, they introduced a C group. And even they are planning to introduce a lot of new namespaces. For example, if I have two VMs, I could show two different times to the process. Whereas if I use container, I cannot do that. So in order to do that, I need to have a time namespace. So there are some discussion on adding those. So like that, similarly, they are planning to add some security modules as well. Okay. So let's look at some example namespace. So first I'm going to take is UTS. UTS is nothing but the name Unix Time Sharing System, but basically it keeps information about the system like host name, what is the release version, etc. So now the goal is we need to show two different host name to two different process within the same machine. I'm not creating any virtual machines. Okay. For that, we need to create a separate UTS namespace for those process, and then we can set the host name. Okay, let's see, there is a hardware and then I have operating system, and by default operating system has something called UTS data structure, and the data structure looks like this. So especially the node name is the one that actually holds the host name, and any process that running on the operating system, whenever it executes the command host name, it actually gets whatever that is present in the node name. Okay, now what I want to do is I need to create two process. And I want to show different host name to this process. That is my goal. Okay. So that's what the namespace tried to control, right? So we are trying to mimic what we got in two virtual machine without using VM. Okay. So here what happens is whenever I create a new UTS namespace, it actually clones this structure. So it's like a copy of the structure is created for these two process. And this process, if it changes the host name, then that is like a copy, different copy. So now here we have three different copies of UTS data structure. So let's look at, so this is nothing but a container. Okay, if I just create UTS namespace, that itself is called container. Okay, let's look at the difference between virtual machine, how the UTS is managed versus just UTS namespace. So here we have two different UTS data structure because we have started two guest operating system, because every operating system comes up with its own structure, right? So that's why we have created this three replicas of UTS data structure. Whereas here with container, what we have done is we have removed the guest operating system, and still we provided a way to create a clone or copy of a UTS data structure so that we can change it and then show different view to the process. So we will have a lab session in which you will actually create this. So next, so far I said what is UTS namespace, right? So next the question is like how to create a namespace. So we need to use a system call. Okay. So system call is basically a way for a user space application to communicate with the kernel space application. So if you are not aware of user space and kernel space, just hold on for a minute. I will come there. So in this figure, you can see that there are hardware and the network and files. All of them are managed by the kernel. And then we have application. And application need to communicate with the kernel via a system call. Okay. So why we need to have this? Why can't application directly run on, usually application directly run on CPU. So why we need to have this system call, right? So if you look at, this is like a CPU virtual structure. Okay. The CPU has like four rings. So each ring actually control what is the privilege level of the application that is running on the CPU. So when application is running on ring 0, it can access all the CPU instructions. So because CPU is basically having set of instructions, right? Based on that only, it runs all the program. So kernel run in the ring 0 so that it can access all the CPU instruction. Whereas application runs on ring 3, whereas application is usually untrusted when it is running on the operating system, because operating system is the main component, and usually the assumption is that operating system does not trust anybody that is running above it. So that's why it runs the application on ring 3. So if application want to run some special instruction, obviously it need to ask kernel to run it. So that's where the system call comes into play. Okay, then kernel can check whether this guy has enough permission to create or access that machine instruction, and then based on that it can reject or accept. Okay, so that's why we have a system call. So in order to create a namespace also, we need to call a system call based so that the kernel can create the namespace. Okay, so which system call? That is the second question, right? So we have a system call which is called a clone. So you might have heard about fork. So you can take clone as an advanced version of fork. So basically clone, what it does is it actually create a new process with a new namespace. So for I will also show a demo, and you also have a lab session, you will exactly do what I'm going to do now. So this is the system call. So you can see there is a clone and it receives some kind of flags, and this flag is the one which actually denotes what new namespaces we need to create for this process. So these are the flags. So we can set any, suppose say if I want to create only a new UTS namespace. So in this flag, I will just keep clone new UTS. So whenever it creates a new process, it will put that process under the new UTS namespace. So there is something called parent and child, right? So I will, in the next couple of slides, I am going to explain that, because this is very important for to understand how containers works. Okay, so parent-child relationship between process, we will see. So every process, if you look at it, that has a parent. Okay, that's how the Linux has been designed. Okay, so when the system boots up, the first process that the Linux create, it's called init or systemd. So that is the first process created by the kernel, and this process create all the other process. So let's see with one example. So there is a command called ps tree, which actually print the tree of those parent child relationship. And if I go to the first, the root of the tree. Yeah, in the root of the tree, you can see something called systemd. So that is the first process that is created by the operating system. So if you are running some older version of Linux, you might be seeing something called init.d. So that was the available with the older Linux kernel. So they upgraded with the systemd because init actually creates the process serially during the boot process. So they wanted to make it parallel, so that's why they went with the systemd. And even we can see, so I am running something called terminator, right? So let's see where the terminator is in this. Yeah, maybe for that I need to reduce the size a bit. So here you can see there is a terminator. So that is the process that on which I am running the command. You can see how it is created. From systemd, it created genome session. From genome shell, I created terminator. So we are using something called fish shell. Okay, and then there is a ps tree is the command I just executed. You can see the whole parent child relationship. So that's what, so every process need to have a parent. Okay, so here for the ps tree, the parent is the fish. So for fish shell, the parent is the terminator. So that's how the Linux works, and this is important to understand how the container is being created. So that's why I'm explaining this. Okay, so suppose say so just whatever I did, I'm going to explain how exactly it actually creates a new process. So I'm running, suppose say there is a program with some arguments, and then I'm having some bash variable as well, and this is shell. Okay, so this text is going as an input to the shell. So shell is itself is a compiler, some kind of code. It actually receives the input and then do some kind of compilation. So it does lexical analysis and then parsing. Then it does some expansion. So here expansion means, so I'm using a variable, right? $home. It actually points to a home directory. So it actually expands that with the home directory. Then it ready to create a new process. It's a child process so that I can run the program. that I'm just want to run. So it uses the system called clone and then runs the program. Okay. So just now I said clone is the system call which is used to create the container, right? So are we creating container whenever we run something on the shell? That is the next question that we will ask. But that's not true. So because only if you set flag, you will actually create a new container. If you are not setting any flag to the clone, then you wouldn't be creating a new container. Okay, so here this is a child and this is a parent, and by default this is a container. Okay, so when you start a Linux box, you are literally in a container only. Okay, so that container uses global namespace. Okay, so let's see what I mean by that. Let's take some process. Okay, so the question is, so I'm running a process on a Linux. Is it running by default on a container? Okay.
Some kind of containment.
Yeah, some kind of containment. I would say the answer is yes. Okay. So by default, when you are running, suppose say I have a terminator, right? So in the terminator, I am running ls. Okay. So that ls is actually running in a container, but the container is already created when the system actually started. Okay, it is not, I am already in a container. When you actually get a genome or KDE window, at the time itself you are in a container. Okay, whenever I am running ls, it is running within that container. It is not creating a new container, it is running within a container. So I am just going to show, if you hold on for a minute, I can show that there is a global namespace. So that is assigned to all the process. So let's see. So proc is a file system that is used by the kernel to share some information with the user space. Okay, I am going to see what is the namespaces that were created for process one. Okay. So you can see by default there is 7 namespace for the process one. So any process, process one is the first process created by the container, right? I mean created by the Linux boot up process. So by default, every program that I run in this terminal actually gets the same namespaces. So it's because by default everything in a single container, right? So let's go into some other process. So I'm saying process 10. So you can look at the IDs. If you look at the ID, you can see that it is exactly the same. C group IDs is same. Go for PID, so PID end with 836, right? So here also PID end with 836. So by default, all 7 namespaces are created, and whenever you create a new child using clone, it just inherits the namespace attributes of the parent, unless I specify a new flag. So for example, when I create, suppose a process 10, process with ID 10, if I ask it to create under a new UTS namespace, then here you will see a different ID. So I'm anyway going to show in a few slides. So does this answer your question? So that's what it happened. So there is a global namespace. Whenever I create a new process, it's inside the global namespace only, unless I use clone with some flag. Okay. Now how to use a clone to create a container? Okay. So far I haven't created a container. So we just started a process in an already existing container. Now let's see how to create a container. So suppose say I want to run bin bash, that is the command that I want to run within a container. It's a new container I want to run. Okay, so what I can do is I can pass clone and then some flag, right? If I use some flag, I can create a new container and then run that program. But unfortunately, I cannot do that. In order to do that, I need to change the fish code, because fish is a shell. That is the one which actually takes the command that I gave as an input and then create a new process. By default, it uses a clone system call without any flag. So in order to do that, I need to change the fish shell, which I don't want to do that because it's little complex. So instead, what I'm going to do is, from the program that I'm starting, I'm going to clone. It's like a clone is a way to create a new child process with a flag. Basically, whenever I specify a flag, I'm creating a container. So there is one program it will going to create, which is called a setup, that is a child. and this is a container. Okay, is this clear, or if you have any question? So suppose, say, if I have the question that he asked was, so when we fork a process, so by default we are creating the process in the global namespace, and when we use clone, and then when we specify a flag, we are creating a new container. So is there any other question, I mean any other confusion here? So if you look at it, so the shellfish and then program, everything is running on a global namespace. Yeah. Okay, so if we go back, so these are the flags. So basically they issue a clone, right? Clone command is being executed, and they need to specify a flag. Whenever they specify a flag, it actually creates the new namespace. Suppose say I am not specifying any flag, okay, then it is going to take all the namespaces of my parent. The parent by default have a namespace that is inherited from the first process. Okay, that is a global namespace. So whenever you want to, suppose say, create a new UTS namespace, I will just a flag here. Yeah, so the question is, so I have a shell, and then I'm running another shell within that. So for example, from bish I can start a bash. Okay, so it is a child of fish, and it will be in the same global namespace, unless I create that the shell using a new namespace. Yeah, so if it is unclear, so I am going to show some demo. So even after the demo, if it is unclear, you guys are going to exactly run this in the lab session. So there things will become more clear when you are doing things practically. Okay, so here I could actually use clone and then flags, but the problem is, as I said, I need to change the fish, right? So instead what I am doing is, I am creating a program that is a separate program. Okay, so that program is creating a new child process. Because this program I have written, it just like 10 lines of code, okay? So there I can use a clone with some flag, because it is easy for me. So this program is actually running in the global namespace. So global namespace is a big container, that when we start a system itself, there is a big container. So that's where we are running the program, okay? So so you guys know about fork, right? I mean, so you might have used fork. So you just can replace fork with a clone, that's what I am saying. So in a clone you can actually set a flag. So when you set a flag, it will create a new container. That's the basic difference. So here basically, so to come back to your question, so you are asking that why I am doing this. So suppose say I need to create a new process. So what is the way I can create a new process? I can use either fork or clone, okay? So the program is the one that I have written. So that can use either fork or clone to create a new process, okay? The new process that I am creating is, which is called setup, okay? Sorry.
Yeah, I have
this 1 minute, I'll just let me complete her question and then come. So here, so in the program, I am actually using the clone system call with the flag, so that I can create the setup, that is the child, inside a container. So if I don't use any flag, then it will be a normal child process, okay? Okay, so the first program, this is the program, right? That is the one I created using the fish,
right?
Okay, after that I am not using fish. When the program is running, the program is the program parents is fish, okay? But program itself can use system call. When it use system call, it is going to directly ask the operating system to create a new process. Yeah, so I'm using the, I'm using Golang. So Golang uses something called a command.run. So there it internally uses clone. So just to hold on for a minute, I'm going to show the program and we are going to run a demo. So there I will show what is inside a program and what is inside a setup, okay? So inside that we have run the bin bash. The bin bash is the command that I have gave, right? So the red color one is a container, that is a parent namespace. Okay, that is like a global namespace. When you start a system, you have a container, right? So that is this one. So now I have just created a child namespace. This is another container, okay? So let me show the example of this program and then how I am creating a new process without actually using flag, okay? Just to show that how the program works and how the setup works. So So let me show the code first. So hope you guys can see. So this is Golang. So even if you are not familiar with the Go language, it's easy to understand if you have some familiarity with C. So here this is the program. This is this program. Okay. So basically it receives some argument. So that is the argument is like bin bash. So first what it is going to do is it is going to create a command that is like dot dot setup. So setup is like another program. Okay. So yeah, 1 minute. So this program is going to clone and then create a new child that is called a setup. Okay. So if you look at setup, okay, let me create another window. So in this setup, it is actually going to execute the command that I just gave here. So you can see these two are different program. Here I have main and here also I have main. So it says that running parent, it is running child. So basically the program is the first process which is creating the setup process, and then it is again going to run a command called bin bash. Okay. So here I haven't used anything like what is the clone flag. You can see now. So in the parent, I am not using any clone flag. So in the next demo, I will actually use some clone flag. So let's see how this program run and then create a new child. So I'm going to okay. So you can see first it is running the parent, then the parent process is running a the next, it is creating a child, that is the setup, that is another program. And to the setup I actually passed bin bash, right? So it is running a bin bash. So you can see initially I was in fish shell, now I have moved back to bin bash because I am inside a child now. Okay. But I haven't used any flag when I used to clone. So it is actually in the same namespace as well as process one. So even I can so we can probably use ps3. Yeah, sorry. Yep. Yeah, it's I need to reduce the size again. So in your lab session actually you will be using ps3 to check whatever I have done here. So you can see terminator and then fish. I'm using a sudo program, so it is creating a sudo child. Then I'm running a program. Okay, so that is the process creation. Then program created setup. Okay, from setup program I actually created the bash. So bash is the command line that I gave. So instead of bash I can give anything else. For example, I could also give ls, but it will just exit, because when I give bin bash it's like interactive, so that I am inside a child. When I just give ls, first it creates a parent, it creates a child, it executes the command that I gave, and then it comes out. Okay. So here I haven't used any clone, I mean clone with any flags. Okay. So next we are going to use the same program. Okay. But now I am going to use a clone and then I am going to set a new flag. Okay, whenever I set a new flag, we will create a new container, right? So there is a program called a new UTS. It is going to create a new UTS namespace. So basically it is going to use this function clone and then clone new UTS. So this is the flag I am setting. So it actually create the setup and bin bash in a new container. Okay, let's see that how it works. So the basic thing was clear, right? I mean how the clone, I mean the parent child relationship and how it created. Okay. So here I have yeah, before that let me explain the setup, what we are actually going to do. So in the demo what we are going to do is we have a hardware and then we have operating system. So here we have a UTS data structure and here it is set with a host name equal to fabric2. So any process that I run on top of this operating system will see this hostname. Okay. So now we are going to create two containers. Okay. So this container is going to run setup host one and then bin bash program under a new UTS namespace. So here in this container, if I try to see what is the name set for hostname, it will be host one, and here it will be host two. So that's what we are going to do. We are going to create a new container for this. Okay. So here this is the program. So it's actually, you can see that it is creating setup host one, and this is the system call in which I'm actually passing a flag, clone new UTS. Okay. So when it create a child, the child process is nothing but setup host one. It will be under a new container. Okay. If I don't use this flag, it won't be under a new container. It will be under the global container only. So this is how all the Docker or LXE, I mean, if you have familiarity with those things, they exactly use this function only. So let's see with the demo. So I started a first container. Okay. Let me start the second container as well. Okay, 1 minute. Yeah, it's not splitting. Okay, fine. Let me create a new window itself. So we go into new UTS. And here I started the first container. So here I'm going to start the second container. UTS host 2 and then bin bash. Okay, now we are into two containers now. Okay. So basically, so here if I do a host name, here you can see it's set to host 1. And sorry, where is that other container? Yeah, so here if I do host name, you can see it's set to different thing, it's host 2. So if I come to actual host, here I am seeing Fabric v2, it's completely a different host name. So that's why. So using the clone new UTS, I cloned the whole data structure and I can set any value to it. So only the process that is within this container would actually see the host name, that is host 1. Okay. So let's see whether it has created the process. Oh, this is on a different VM, right? Yeah, I don't know. So here I should be able to split the window, but unfortunately it's not working. Yeah, probably let me close and then reopen. So in the demo session, you guys would be doing exactly what I'm doing here. So that's good. Yeah, now it comes. So this, yeah, I just wanted to show that. So earlier from the proc file system, I actually showed, right, there is a namespace and there is an ID. I just want to show that the UTS ID has been changed for some of the process that is running inside a container. So I'm restarting that container. Okay, so I have started that container. Okay, so actually I have running a child called setup host one, right, that is running inside a container. So let's take the PID of that. So this is the PID of that container that is running. So if I go to ls proc and then PID and then namespace. Okay, so let me create another. So if I show for proc 1 and then ns, so you can see that the UTS namespace is new for this container process. So whereas everything else will be same because I only created the UTS namespace. Okay, so that's what I said here. So by default, when I create any program just with the clone, it will just inherit the namespaces of the parent. When I use some flag, I can create a new namespace. So that's how it will become a container.
Flags for that, for other namespaces.
Yes, yes. So whichever namespace that we want to create, that flag we need to provide. So here I wanted to create a UTS namespace. So that's why I provided that flag. So let me look, show the code one more time. So you can see, right, I am using something called new UTS. So yeah, we can set multiple flag. So in the subsequent demo, I will be showing that. So is that answered your question? So that's all. So if I don't set this, then it means I'm not creating any namespace or new container. Okay. So, so far we have looked at UTS, right? Now I am going to create a new namespace for the mount. So I want to show two different files to two different process. Okay. So that's what is the new mount namespace will do. So I have a program called new UTS MNT. So it is going to use two flags. Okay. And it is using the two flags. It goes to create a container and then it will put that container under the new UTS and then the new mounts namespace. Okay, so in the demo, this is what we are going to do. So we have operating system and we are going to create two process, two set of containers. And these containers, by default, I'm creating a new UTS as well, right? So we will have a different host names. Then on the host, we have a mount list. So basically the host OS, any process that is running on the host OS can view all the files. Whereas in the first container, I want to change its root directory. So whatever process that I'm running inside this container, I want to show home synthil lab host 1 go.1.12.7 as the root container. So this whatever process that I'm running inside this container will only see this file. Okay, that's what mount namespace allow us to do. So as I have created a new mount namespace, I can change anything I want and then try to control the view of a process. Similarly for the container 2, I'm going to show go 1.13.4. Okay. So we are doing this without using two operating system. So if you want to do a simplest way, you just need to create a two VM. So by default, those two VMs will have a different mount list. Now without using operating system, we are creating a mount list. You can take it like there is a mount list structure and we are just cloning that structure, and that structure I can change it in any way I want. So whatever process that is running inside that container will only see what the content of that particular structure. Okay, so let's see in action. So how it works out. So in demo also you guys would be running this. Okay, so here you can see I'm actually passing the two namespaces because I'm creating a two container. And then in setup.program, you can see that I'm changing the root, I mean the root directory of that particular container here. Okay, and I'm also setting a path for go root so that when I run go version, it actually can know that where to look at. Okay. So let's create this. So I'm going to run the program. So it created a one container and I'm going to run the another next, create the next container. Okay, I created another container. So you can see if I do go version here, it shows 1.2, and here if you see, it's 1.13. Okay, so we haven't created any VMs. We just created a container and different mount space. Just that mount structure, I'm just manipulating. Okay, so if I do ls, you can see it's different files it is seeing. So for example, here it says with go 1.12, and here also it shows something different. So even I'm not going into more of the detail. So whereas in the lab session, you actually see that from the proc file system, the mount namespace ID has been changed. Okay, this is the way to create a new mount namespace. So in the same container, suppose say if I do px aux, it actually see all the process. So here when I run px aux, px aux is a command that actually find out the process that are running on the system. So it actually see all the process that is running on the host, okay, but I want to control that. So whatever command that I am running within this container, I want to only show the processor that are running in this container, okay. In order to do that, what I need to do, it's simple. I need to create a PID namespace. So PID namespace actually controls the processes seen by any process, right? So that's what the PID namespace will help me to do that. So here I need to pass all the three commands. So new UTS, new namespace, and the new PID. So if I do that, if I run PX AUX, I can control the list of processes seen by the container. Okay. So in the demo, this is what we are going to do. So we have a hardware and then the operating system and then list of a process that is running. So any process that is running on the OS can see all the process. Okay. Now what I want to do is I need to create a container with setup host one and then bin bash. These are the two programs that is running within the container. And here I want to restrict the process view of this container. Okay. So here I want to make this container to see only the process that are running within this container. Okay. So in order to do that, I need to create a PID namespace. That you can again think it like it's cloning the PID structure and then it tries to manipulate how a process can view the process list. So let me exit from these two.
Yeah.
Yeah. So the question is, so there are different set of container tool implementation is there. So can we, is it create a different set of namespaces whenever it creates a container? Yeah. So it depends on the implementation. So because if you look at the namespace list that I showed, till 2008 or 7, there were only 4 or 5 namespaces. Okay. So whereas Docker came during that time itself. So at that time they were using just 4 namespaces, then slowly the other namespaces got added by the Linux operating system. So then whenever the new Docker version was released, they added those namespaces as well. Okay, so it depends on the implementation. Okay, so the question is, can I tell more about the namespaces from the Linux perspective, right? Okay, so so the namespace, in C++ there is something called namespace, right? So if you are aware of C++ programming, we can specify something called namespace. So within the namespace, if I create a variable, only any function that is written in that namespace can see the variable. So if I create another namespace, that namespace cannot see what is inside this namespace. Okay, the same concept is used here. Okay, the name is given that way. Okay, but Linux is the first one to implement namespaces in the operating system. Yeah, so 1 minute. I will come to that. So at the end of the slide, I will discuss about how they are doing it. Yes, namespace is nothing but a scope. But the how we are creating the scope differs with the operating system. Yeah, so is there any other question? Okay, so I will just continue with the demo. So now we are going to create a new PID namespace as well. Yeah, for that just one window is good enough. So here I have a program. So you can see that it is actually using all the three namespace flag, UTS and then new NS. New NS is nothing but a new mount namespace and then new PID. So all the three we are creating. And let's start the process. and then bin bash. Okay, I'm inside the container. So if I do px aux, you can see that I'm just only seeing three process, because now I have controlled the process view of this container. So if I run the same command at the host, you can see that I'm seeing lot of process. Okay, and also you can see here the process ID is 1. Okay, so actually what happens is, so this is the tree, assume that this is the process tree, the first process is 1 and then it created a bunch of child process. Okay, this is the parent PID namespace, the whole thing is the parent PID namespace. We have created a child PID namespace, so this is the container. Okay, so the 8 is the PID that is seen at the parent namespace, because that is the actual, okay, by the maintained by the operating system, whereas 1 is the virtual ID of the container. Okay, so you can actually see using px and then grep, etc. So we have a, in the lab session you actually can see, so what is the PID, so here it is PID 1, right? So you can see what is the exact PID of the process in the host. Okay, yeah, so whereas if you take virtual machine, the host operating system cannot see the processes running in the virtual machine. Okay, whereas in container we can see that. So we found one flaw, right? So though the container is trying to replace guest operating system virtual machine, there are some drawbacks. So this is one of the drawbacks. So the container can leak some information to the host OS, whereas when I am running virtual machine cannot leak any information to the host OS. So especially when we run this container in a cloud, in a physical machine, the other, my competitor also might be running their container. Okay, so then we would be leaking some process information. So that's why usually the container itself is started inside a VM. So we will discuss that later. Okay, yeah, so this is what we just did. Yeah, this is for creating a network namespace. So by default, any process that is running on the operating system can see all the network interfaces that is available to the host. Now I want to create a container and then want to restrict the network interfaces seen by that container. Okay, so using that I can actually assign a different network interface, different IP address also. So suppose I am running a process and it can use a different IP address and port number, whereas actual IP of this network card would be completely different. Okay, we can play around all this, because when you are using VM you actually do that. Now we are doing that without using the VM. So let's see one demo in action. So new UTS, MNT, PID and then net. Let me close that. Yeah, so here you can see I have appended a new flag, that is new net. So it is going to create a new network namespace. So let me run the program. I want to run bin bash. So now I am inside a container. So if I do IPA, you can see that it only shows the loopback device, there is no interfaces it is showing. If I do the same command on my host, I can see there are a lot of things. Okay, so here I have a lot of interfaces, whereas I have here only a few interfaces. So even there is using IP, we can create new interface, assign IP address and then attach it to the container. So that's what the Docker and all does. So in order to do this manually, it's very time consuming. So that's why people have built tool like Docker or LXE, which can do that. So even when I was explaining this mount namespace, right? So even the creation of this folder is also very time consuming. So that's why in the Docker, there is something called Docker image. So we can create this folder like an image. So Docker has a mechanism to easily create mount points for the containers. So whereas if I need to do it manually, then it's a lot of effort. Okay, so there are other system calls also, something like unshare. So what it does is, so suppose say I am a process, so I am a caller. So using unshare, I can actually create a new namespace for myself. Okay, there is also a Linux command called unshare. Okay, suppose let's execute this command and then see. So unshare hyphen hyphen net, and then I'm doing bin bash. Oh, I'm inside a container, so let me exit. Okay, so if I do IPA, you can see that I am only seeing a loop. Okay, I haven't run any program that I have created, I am just using the command unshare. Okay, that is the command provided by the Linux itself. Okay, so that actually created a new namespace. You can actually see that it has, we can create all the other namespaces as well. So mount, UTS, IPC, and all those things. Similarly, we have another program which is called NS Enter. So, suppose say I am a process, so I am a caller, so I am running suppose say on a host OS, okay. So, I can make myself move into a container, so that is what the NS Enter is doing. So, it is like a namespace enter, okay. So, let me show a demo for that, and then things will become more easier. Okay, I am starting a container, okay, I have started a container, and you can see these are the process that is running inside the container. Yeah, so first I need to find out, so suppose say I am going to create a program on the host, okay, that program need to move into a container namespace, okay, this namespace it needs to move to. So here basically in the command what it says is NS Enter, and then enter into a new namespace, that is a PID namespace of one of the process. There could be some existing process and it is inside one namespace, whatever namespace that process is using. So, I also want to enter that namespace, that is what we are going to try to do that. So, in order to do that, I need to first find out, this is the container, right. So, all the process within a container shares a name, same namespace. So, just to find out what is the PID namespace of a setup host. So, PXAUX, and then for that I first I need to find out the process ID. So, you can see process ID is 11448. Yeah. So, I mean the use cases obviously I am not sure how people would use it. So, so there are few example in which people have created a Docker container, okay, in a production, and they want to run some monitoring tool, okay, just for like a short time inside that container. So there I have seen people using NS Enter and then getting inside the container, but I haven't seen the very real use case for that, but that is one example of using that. Okay. Yep. Yeah, so you can see here the process ID is one, but the process ID for the same process setup host is different, as I said in the past. So now I am going to create a new process, and which is going to use, yeah, let me, so 14448. So this is the process. So I am saying that enter into this namespace. So, this process has a PID namespace, enter into that namespace and then run the command sleep of 1000. I am doing that from the host, okay. So, yeah, I need to use sudo, I am forgetting that very often, okay, it has entered, okay. So, if I do PXAUX, I can see the sleep here. I executed the command from host and that process entered into a new container and it is running there, and I can exit. For example, I can here do PXAUX also, yeah, but this actually does not do that, okay, fine. Okay, so in the lab session also you guys play around these command, and okay, these are the other system calls. So even these system calls can be used from a program. So, so far I showed only the Linux command, but you can use it inside a program.
Can I tell some processes?
Yeah, you can do that. So in the demo you can actually try that out. So, because we know the PID, right, so we can kill that, whereas in, if I use virtual machine, we do not, we have that security, but here we do not have the security. So, there are a lot of research going on in improving the security of containers, okay. So, so far we looked at namespaces, So how to control a view of a process, that's a namespace. So now we will be looking into a control groups. So control groups is basically a way to control the resources used by a process. Okay, suppose say I want to allocate just 10 MB for whole one container, then I can do that using the container. So because in the VM we can do that, right? So for example, so in the VM, if I go to settings in the system, so you can see that I can control the amount of memory allocated and the number of process that is allocated to the VM. So we need to have the same control for the containers as well. So that's where the C group comes. So in order to configure that, so Linux actually provide some file system called a sys file system, using which, okay, I need to get out of the container. Okay, yeah. Yeah, so Linux provides something called a sys file system. Using that, we can send any values to the kernel. Okay, whereas proc file system is a way for kernel to share some information with the user space, whereas sys, from using sys, we can pass some value to the kernel. Okay, so you can see by default, so as I said, there is a default namespace. Similarly, there is a default C group. So you can see this is the default C group, and each of this folder will have a lot of configuration parameters. For example, if I go into memory dot limits in bytes, you can see it's like what is the memory limit for any process that is running in my machine. So this is like a default value. Okay. So in order to create something like the new C group for a container, so we need to create a new folder and then new memory limits, and then set that memory limit. So we in fact have a demo for that. Let me do that. So there is a C group. Okay, sorry. So you can see setup on.go. Yeah, so here you can see I'm going to create a new C group. Okay, the C group folder is IAC IBM, and then I'm going to set limit in bytes for like 1 MB. So I'm going to create a container, and I'm saying that any process that is running inside a container cannot use more than 1 MB. Let's see what happens. Obviously it wouldn't run because 1 MB is too less for any container. PAD host. Yeah. Oh, it executed actually. Let me build. Yeah, probably here I have some problem in the code, but usually it doesn't run. So I need to, yeah. So you got the concept, right? So this is how it works. So we can set any resource restriction for a container using C groups. Okay, that's where the C group is being used. Yeah, so far I showed lot of programs, and probably it might have confused many of you. And if there is any confusion, you can do the same thing that I did in this presentation in the lab. So I have written a detailed instruction, step-by-step instruction. So you can go over and then try to understand how the namespaces are created, how containers are created. But in a real world, you don't need to do that. Okay, so people already used those system calls to create a tools so that we can easily build and then start a container. Okay, the first one is like a Linux container, that is LXE, then OpenVis came, and then there is something called RKT, and now the popular one is Docker. So that is these are the tools using which we can easily create containers. Yes, so all the accountings are available, so we can measure like how many cycles of CPU is being used. So what is the memory that is being used? So whatever, so let me show, there is something called a CGGet. So you can see, I mean, even we can set like what is the limit in bytes, usage in bytes. We can set the number of process that is running inside a container. So we can actually I mean, restrict the number of process that can be started within a container. So all the things that we need, I mean, the user need to put some restriction, all the things are available. Similarly, for accountability also, it actually takes care of the memory utilization and then CPU utilization, disk utilization and then network utilization. We can control everything. For example, suppose say I'm running a container, I want to measure or account, I mean, like monitor the network utilization, I can do that. I want to restrict the network bandwidth of a container. For example, I have 1 GB network bandwidth, but I want my container to use only say 10 MB per second. So I can do that. So, so all the values we need to set it inside this. Okay, there is something called CGGet. So using CGGet, we can actually find out what is the actual config. So you can do it for all. Yeah, net is not there. Okay. Okay, is there any other question on control groups? Yeah, sir, the voice was not clear. So.
So in case of release, we can use KVM sandboxing, right?
Yeah, so we can use sandboxing, we can go for lightweight virtual machines, okay, that is alternative. So in fact, Mac OS, when you are running Docker on a Mac OS, Mac operating system does not have any implementation of namespace. So it actually will use a lightweight virtual machine. So to avoid the leak, my suggestion would be to use the lightweight virtual machine. That's what all the cloud provider does. So now people have created a virtual machine just to run container. It's like very, very minimal operating system that allow you to run the container. That is the best mechanism, I would suggest. Yeah, there was a question. Yes. So when we are starting a Docker, there is a flag that using that we can actually set what is the privilege level. So by default, it runs like a user application. And if you want to run, suppose say some root command within the Docker, you can need to say that --- privileged equal to true or something like that. So that will make the application to run in a privileged mode. Yeah. Is there any other question? So we are not having a own OS, we are having a different files, that's it. So when you are specifying that, what it does is Ubuntu package management is completely different, right? Whereas Red Hat package management is very different. So in a container, when you are creating a process, the process is actually created by Red Hat, not the Ubuntu, okay? So you have required files in the container image that allow you to install, for example, dev file, or you can use apt-get install. So you have set of files, libraries, and then program within the container that can understand the command that you are running. But whatever process that we are running or network interface that we are running, everything is done by the host OS only. So we don't have a specific lecture as such. So you can say that different, tools provide different features. That's what I could say. For example, if you have LXE, LXE is the first basic version and it is like more lightweight. It's not very heavyweight like Docker. And if you want to create like simple container, and we can use it with LXE. Whereas if you want to go for a very complex system and then production setup, I would say go for Docker. So it depends. So it's like we have Eclipse. We have VS Code, etc., right? So it depends on people preference, each one provide different features. Yeah, so architecture wise, all these guys are using the namespace and control groups that I just explained. Yes, all are open source. Yeah. Okay, so when, suppose say, I'm running a proper virtual machine, okay? Suppose my process actually requires some special kernel module that I have written. I want to load that kernel module into that virtual machine and my process would use that. For that, I will definitely go for full OS based, okay? Now, I just want to create a container. I don't have any special kernel module, okay? I'm not going to use all the features that are provided by the operating system, okay? So in that case, what I need the VM to allow me to create namespaces, okay? That's how I create a container, right? So I will remove all the unnecessary kernel module that are not required to just to run the container. Okay, and then I just, that's how I get the very lightweight. So there is something called Core OS that is like a lightweight VM to even Amazon also have something called starts with Fire. So that is also very, sorry, Firecracker. So that is like a lightweight VM. It has adequate functionality just to create a container, but you cannot do like special kernel module. Those things are not possible. Okay. So as I mentioned, so in the example, right? So I haven't created any new network interface. I just showed the loopback. So there is some command called IP or OpenVS. So using that, we can create a network interface. It will actually create a network bridge. It's like a virtual hardware switch inside the host operating system. And on top of it, I have a lot of virtual network interface. And so I have, I mean, you can assume it like we have a physical hardware. So I'm creating a virtual hardware using software in the OS, and that's what those containers are going to use.
Okay, so when it is, when it wants to communicate to the outside world, so does it have access to the network interface from the host?
So, okay. So when it is trying to do some network access, so obviously that control need to come to the host OS kernel.
So
okay.
Okay, so it is not keeping that Docker network, whatever. So will there be a duplicate packets, one is from the Docker to the host and then from host to the...
Yes, that's how it happens.
So there is a performance hit, right?
So even in VM, that's what it happens. Okay. So see, for example, even if I'm running a, I mean, these are just a process, right? So suppose say I'm running a process on top of operating system and it is using a socket. So when I'm saying that transfer this data, the data is copied from user space to the kernel space, then it need to copy to the NIC buffer, then it goes out. Okay, when I'm running inside the container some process and it is trying to send some data, first it will come to that virtual bridge.
Yes.
That I had.
Yes.
Okay, from the virtual bridge it will go to the operating system, then it will go outside.
Okay.
So the network performance will drop. Yeah, it will simply actually, it depends on the implementation of virtual bridge. So whatever question that you are asking, it's also applicable for VMs as well. So I have two VMs and those two VMs are inside the same physical machine and they are communicating with each other. So whether it will go to the OS or whether it will directly communicate, again, it depends on the implementation. There are different ways to implement it, but the same thing is what people do here as well. So especially the network and image management is very complex in container. That's why we go for Docker. So in fact, if you use a default network capability of Docker, so if I have suppose say 1 Gbps link, I might get only 200 or 300 MB per second. Okay. So the people are working on it. So there are a lot of research going on. So there is something called overlay network and people are trying to optimize it to increase the bandwidth. And now there are a lot of work currently is there, which actually gets you full network bandwidth. Yeah, I am not sure. Sorry. So these are the list I just wanted to mention, but I haven't gone over all of them. So I basically use LXC or Docker. Yeah. Well, I mean, 1000 Mbps to 200 Mbps for the normal Docker setup. And that's what I said. Now there are a lot of new network plugins are there that will allow you to use full 1 Gbps. So it's that's what the overlay concept in Docker is very complex. So that itself would require a separate lecture. And so probably in offline, I can share you a lot of papers in which people are trying to optimize the Docker networking performance. Okay, so this is the final slide. Somebody also asked, right? So can a container be created on Windows and then Mac OS? So only in Windows 10, they actually introduced the concept of namespaces. Okay, so that now we can create a container on Windows 10 using the native container, because the namespace, whatever I said, clone new NS, that is actually supported by the Windows operating system itself. Okay, whereas before Windows 10, like Windows 7 or 8, or whatever you use. At the time, there were no native container support. If you do clone new NS, operating system would not understand what it is. So what at the time they did was, the Windows actually has hypervisor that is called Hyper-V, and then Hyper-V ran a lightweight virtual machine. Okay, on that lightweight virtual machine, they started a container. So if you can install Docker on Windows 7, this is what you are actually doing. You are running it on a lightweight virtual machine. As a result, you cannot see the process that are running in the container in the host, because now we are using VM, right? So as somebody asked, can I use lightweight VM to avoid the leak? So here we can do that. And what about Mac? So Mac still now does not have any support for native container. So again, what they do is they actually create a lightweight VM, you called Linux Kit VM. And on top of that only, they actually run the Docker. So if you install Docker on Mac, that's what happens. So this is how exactly it looks. So there is a Mac OS, and then you have hypervisor installed on the Mac OS by default. Then the Docker actually creates Linux Kit VM. That is a lightweight VM just to create Linux containers using the Linux namespaces. The container D is the daemon. So the container D is the actual code that actually creates the container. So it actually uses the namespace clone system call. And this container D can be attached to Kubernetes, Docker, and so other things. They have taken it out so that it's like a very generic module. On top of that, you can run Docker engine and then do all the Docker. So if you are running Mac OS, don't think that Mac is having Mac OS implementation having namespaces, it doesn't. Yeah, so thank you. And mostly I work on blockchain. So I have a blog on blockchain as well. So if you guys are interested in learning more about blockchain, so you can please read that. So whatever I have explained today, so you will be doing in the lab session in the afternoon. So there the things will become more clear. If it is not clear, then you can ask me during the lab session. Yeah. Thanks, guys.